Welcome to the course on Advanced Machining Process. Today we are going to discuss on modeling and simulation of surface emulsion in magnetorheological abrasive flow finishing process. So this is our experimental setup of magnetorheological abrasive flow finishing process. Here, so we can see this setup. Here, this is the media cylinder, top media cylinder. This is the bottom media cylinder, and this is the finishing zone here. So this finishing zone here, it is exaggerated. So finishing zone where actually we keep our work pieces for polishing to take place, and on that work piece, on that zone only where we want the polishing, we apply magnetic field there where we need the finishing only. So you can see here two poles of the electromagnet here, north pole and south pole here we kept. So for the current analysis, we are not considering any electromagnet, so we are considering only permanent magnet. So you can see here the fixture, workpiece fixture here. So this is workpiece fixture as well as your magnet fixture. So you can see here these magnets are there at the cylindrical surface, at the external surface of the magnet fixture we kept permanent magnets. So these magnets are neodymium, iron, boron. So simply it is called as N. So we have considered two types of magnets, one is N17 and N48, two grades of magnets actually we have considered. So these magnets are kept just opposite to each other, so that's why you can see here this is the north pole and this is the south pole. So one thing we want to say here, so this is only magnetorheological abrasive flow finishing process, and we are not applying any rotational motion of the magnets. So only these magnets are actually fixed here. Like in magnetorheological abrasive flow finishing, so these magnets are fixed, we are not considering any rotation to the magnets in the current case. So in this exaggerated view of the workpiece fixture, you can see, so this is the extrusion process here, at the top portion there is an extrusion process. So here it is connected to the media cylinder, and this is the finishing zone at the center, finishing zone where we have applied magnetic field. So these two poles are there, north pole and south pole. So you can see the magnetic lines of force here. So all these carbolin iron particles are forming chains here, you can see. So these chains are not a continuous chain because we have mixed abrasive particles are there. So these abrasive particles, when it comes in between this chain path, these chains breaks. So all these chains are not continuous chain. And also this is the simulation we have considered, it is in the static case. So although during finishing MR polishing fluid it is given a reciprocating motion, but in the current case we have considered this is a static case where these fluid are fixed here. Okay, so this permanent magnets, you can see here at inside what are the forces are coming. So because of this magnetic field, so magnetic normal force will be there, and one axial force is there because of this reciprocating motion or axial motion of the fluid, reciprocating motion of the fluid, or fluid is flown through the cylindrical fixture with a very high pressure. So because of that also magnetic means axial force is there, also one normal force is there, also magnetic force is there due to this applied magnetic field. So these abrasive particles are held in this zone only by in between this carbon and iron particles. So here in this finishing zone where you are applying magnetic field, so we kept our work pieces. So you can see here this at this workpiece fixture, we kept these flat work pieces there at the internal slots of the workpiece. So these two work pieces are kept just diametrically opposite to each other. So one is in front of this north pole, another one is the in front of the south pole. So here this MR fluid in this zone, it behaves as a non-Newtonian fluid with the application of magnetic field, but where we are not applying any magnetic field, there fluid actually behaves as a Newtonian fluid. So here and here these fluids are actually behaving as a non-Newtonian fluid. And one more thing is that with respect to workpiece, okay, so with respect to this magnet axis, so this axis, you can see this top surface, top portion of the extrusion is similar to the bottom portion, is the bottom portion of the extrusion. So in the first stroke, so to this piston is moving from top media cylinder to the bottom media cylinder. Okay, So bottom portion of the mediastinal layer, top top to the bottom. So if this fluid is moving from the top mediastinal layer to the bottom mediastinal layer. So extrusion actually in the first cycle, extrusion is from the top mediastinal layer to the bottom mediastinal layer. And in the next cycle, actually this extrusion process happens on the bottom mediastinal layer to the top mediastinal layer. So these two processes are symmetric with each other. So that's why for the finishing zone, we have considered this portion. And this portion, so this portion only we have considered for finished means for simulation, because these two portions are similar to each other. Also, we have considered only one half of the fixture because we have considered here axisymmetric case. Okay, so because of this axisymmetric case, we have considered only one half of the fixture here in the current process. So here you can see how many forces are there. On the abrasive particles which are taking part into the surface, taking part in the finishing process. So, so here this is shown in the finishing zone, this workpiece fixture. So, you can see at the internal surface of this workpiece fixture, two workpieces are kept here. So, these CIP particles are forming chains along the lines of magnetic field. So, because of this reciprocating motion of this polishing medium, so two forces are there, one is the axial force, which is axial force, and another one is the radial force. So these radial force are perpendicular to the abrasive particles. So this is the radial force here. Okay, so this is the radial force here. So which is perpendicular to the abrasive particles. Okay, so this because of this radial force, these abrasive particles are indented into the workpiece surface. Okay, now for the cutting to take place, the abrasive particles has to be moved forward. So it gives for moving forward this axial force actually coming into picture. So because of this axial force, this whatever indented materials are there, it is removed from the workpiece surface. So there are because of this reciprocating motion or extrusion of this polishing media inside the workpiece fixture, two forces are there. One is the radial force, another one is the axial force. So because of this radial force, indentation occurs, and because of this axial force, so this whatever materials are there, it is whatever indented materials by the abrasive particles are there, it is removed from the workpiece surface. These indented materials are removed from the workpiece surface. Now another force is there because of this iron particles are attracted toward the poles, toward the north and south poles of the magnets. Okay, so because of that, actually these CIP particles chains are forming. These in between these chains, abrasive particles are held. So because of these magnets, magnetic particles are surrounding these abrasive particles. So one magnetic force also it is acting on the abrasive particles through CIP particles chains. So these magnetic particles also it is added normal to the workpiece surface. So whatever the total normal force into the workpiece surface is magnetic force and plus axial force, magnetic force and radial force. So this is the total force. There one is the radial force, another one is the magnetic force. These two forces are helping in indentation into the workpiece surface. Now axial force, actually whatever indented materials are there, it is removed from the workpiece surface because of this axial force. Okay, so this resultant of these two forces actually do the polishing operation. Okay, so now in this picture, in the first picture, you can see here the CIP particles chains are actually surrounding the abrasive particles, giving the bonding strength to this abrasive particles. When this abrasive particles is moving forward because of this axial motion, so because of this axial force, actually whatever indented undulations are there, it is coming as in the form of chips. So this for indentation to take place, this axial force should be more than the resistance offered by the workpiece material. So this FA should be greater than this resistance offered by the workpiece material. Okay. So medium flow is from left to right hand side directions. Now when axial force is greater than radial force, so then cutting occurs. In the second case, axial force is less than the radial resistance force. So when axial force is less than the radial resistance offered by the workpiece material, or F capital R, So in that case, what happens? These abrasive particles, whatever indented into the workpiece surface, is not able to remove the surface undulations from the workpiece surface, although it is indented. So in that case, these abrasive particles will rotate itself, and because of rotation, this depth of indentation actually adjusted. It adjusted, adjusted automatically. So after it's adjusting its depth of indentation into a lower value or lesser value, this at that point actually axial force is greater than resistance force F capital R. Okay, so in that case, these abrasive particles will remove the small depth of indentation from the workpiece surface. Now this is the third case here, when axial force, again it is greater than resistance force. So here whatever indented material is there, it will actually remove the surface indentation. In the first case, actually it is just equal to the resistance force, so the indentation will start. Okay, so these are the three cases are there where if axial force just equal to the radial force, resistance force. Okay, so in that case indentation is ready to start. And in the second case, axial force is less than radial force, resistance force. So in that case, this abrasive particle will rotate, and based on its axial force, okay, so it will adjust itself and it will cut with a lesser depth of indentation because of its rotation. And the third case, axial force is very greater than resistance force. In that case, whatever indentation is there, it will remove the surface undulations accordingly. So these things are actually simulation of this magnetological abrasive flow finishing is required to automate the process. We want to automate the process during machining. Okay, so what are the forces are there? So total force is, because of this extrusion pressure, axial force, and this radial force is there. So this axial force and radial force can be calculated from the computational fluid dynamics simulation. So we shall discuss that thing now. So from the computational fluid dynamics simulation of the polishing medium, we can calculate the axial force and radial force. Now this magnetic force actually can be calculated from magnetic field analysis. This FM can be calculated from the magnetic field analysis. And after that, after getting all these forces, we can simulate the surface roughness modeling. Okay, so we have to do the surface roughness modeling. Okay, so after doing that surface roughness modeling, whatever surface roughness we get or we achieve, so that can be compared with the experimental results. So if it is validated, then without doing the experiment, original prototype experiment, we can automate the process. How many, what should be the pressure, what should be the magnetic field, how many finishing cycles we need for getting a certain surface finish, final surface finish. So that is the motto for doing the simulation, for getting the automation, for developing a automation of the system, MRFL process, automation of the MRFL process. Okay. So here you can see the velocity profile in case of Bingham plastic fluid. So Bingham plastic MR magnetological polishing fluid can be considered as a Bingham plastic fluid. So it can be considered as a Bingham plastic fluid after application of the magnetic field. So with the application of magnetic field, you can consider this one as a Bingham plastic fluid. So this is the one of the velocity profile for the cylindrical fixture for one half, because we are considering the axis symmetric case. So this is the one half of the cylindrical fixture. So this is the axis of the cylindrical fixture. So this is the wall of the cylindrical fixture. So you can see the velocity profile here at this portion. Actually velocity profile is constant, so you can get the uniform velocity profile at the center up to this point. So up to V equal to R equal to R0, you can see here R equal to R0, this velocity is constant. Okay, so velocity or RC at code of R equal to RC here, R equal to RC, this velocity is constant. After that, this velocity of this MR fluid, actually it is shear here at this zone. Here this velocity of this MR fluid is shear. So where it is not unsheared, so MR fluid is not sheared in this zone at the center, so it is not sheared. So this zone actually it is called solid core region or unyielded region. Unyielded region or solid core region of the microbiological pulsing fluid. So here this velocity gradient equal to zero. So there is no change in the velocity profile. But after that, in this zone, this fluid is shear. So when radius of the fluid is greater than RC critical radius, in this zone, this velocity of this fluid actually shear. So velocity of the fluid is shear. Fluid is shear here. So we can see the velocity gradient, and at the wall you can see the steepest velocity gradient, which is observed at the wall of the cylindrical fracture. Okay, so MR fluid, to flow the MR fluid, your fluid has to be shear, otherwise it cannot flow. Okay, but one thing is that actually in this unshear region, as the fluid is not shear there, these abrasive particles are held in between the strong magnetic field chains. Okay, and in the shear zone, as the fluid is shear there, all these chain structures are disrupted or broken. So as the chain structures are disrupted or broken, so in that case, as the chain structures are disrupted or broken, so in that case, what happens actually, whatever this MR fluid actually, it is not, the CIP particles are not able to hold the abrasive particles that strongly. So that's why for the better polishing, we need the higher velocity, means higher radius of the solid core region. So here this if RC, critical radius of this fluid, if it is near the wall, so it is near the wall, in that case actually most of the fluid will be unsheared or unyielded. So abrasive particles will be held with a very strong force, and in the this portion will be shear zone. Here actually shear zone is required for the fluid to flow. Okay, so more unyielded region and less yielded region will give the higher polishing rate. Okay. So another thing is that you can see here shear stress is zero here at the center, and shear stress is, applied shear stress is maximum at the wall. So as the applied shear stress is maximum at the wall, when the fluid is flown through the cylinder, okay, so fluid is actually broken, fluid is actually sheared along the wall only, because shear stress is maximum there. Okay, so for this CFD simulation, so we already told CFD simulation is required to calculate the axial force and radial force. Okay, so for the CFD simulation, few things, few assumptions are actually required. The medium is isotropic and homogeneous in nature. So this medium, whatever we are considering, it is isotropic and homogeneous. Although these abrasive particles, CIP particles, are actually homogeneously mixed with the base medium of paraffin oil and grease, but for the sake of actually simulation, we have considered that total fluid consisting of these abrasive particles, as carbon and iron particles and the base media, it consists of a single fluid, single homogeneous fluid. Okay, so we are not considering any three phase flow or two phase flow here, because solid particles are there, liquid also, fluid is also there. Okay, so we are not considering all these things. We are considering MR fluid as a isotropic and homogeneous fluid. So this fluid is incompressible and steady flow fluid. We are considering the steady flow fluid. Okay, so as the fixture is cylindrical, so that's why we are considering the axisymmetric case, and two magnets are actually applied just diametrically opposite to each other. Although this magnetic field is not symmetric, but for the sake of actually simplicity, we have considered this case actually as a axisymmetric. We have considered our case as the axisymmetric. So as the fluid is actually considered as axisymmetric, so we are not means solving this total problem in R and Z plane. R in the radius direction, Z in the axial direction. We are considering the total case as a 2D case. So we are considering R and Z plane. R is the radial direction and Z is the axial direction. So we are not considering the swirling motion of this fluid. So fluid is not rotating, so we are not considering this swirling motion of the fluid. Okay, so we are considering V theta equal to zero. Okay, so this is the governing equations for this MR polishing fluid. These governing equations actually it is solved in Fluent. So Fluent ANSYS. So we have solved this total problem in a Fluent ANSYS compiler or solver. Okay, So continuity equation is del Ui by del Xi. So and momentum equation also it is written in tensor form. So one thing actually you can see here, this if you consider this viscous term here, viscosity of this MR porosity fluid, you can see here this viscosity of this MR porosity fluid is a function of shear rate. So this viscosity is not a constant in case of magnetorheological polishing fluid. So viscosity is a function of shear rate. Also viscosity is a function of magnetic field, and magnetic field viscosity is a function of concentration of CIP. Okay, so viscosity is not constant in case of magnetorheological polishing fluid. So it is a function of shear rate, it is a function of CIP concentration, it is a function of magnetic field. Okay, so as the viscosity is a function of shear rate, so that's why we cannot keep our this viscosity outside of this bracket. So that's why it is kept inside. Viscosity is a function of shear rate and magnetic field. So this is the total domain, computational domain. So here we can see, here again we can show. So this is our domain. So we are considering only this zone. So this zone we are considering only. Okay, so here this is homogeneous means Newtonian fluid here under magnetic field. This is non-Newtonian fluid. Okay, so considering this one here up to this point, from here to here this point, we are not applying any magnetic field, and from here to here we are applying magnetic field. So there are two zones of this flowing fluid. So first one is the zone 1, where we are not applying any magnetic field, and in zone 2 actually at the internal surface of this workpiece fixture we kept our workpiece there, and that's why we have applied magnetic field here. So here in zone 1 this MR fluid as a Newtonian fluid, and in zone 2 actually this MR fluid as the non-Newtonian Bingham plastic fluid. Okay, so this particular dimensions of this fluid actually it is given here. So from here to here it is 62 millimeter, then there is an extrusion of process is there, and from here to here it is 63.8 millimeter. So here this extrusion occurs here. So after extrusion, from here it is outlet, and from here actually it is going to the zone 2, where in zone 2 we have applied this magnetic field. So here in zone 2 actually MR fluid behaves as a non-Newtonian fluid. Okay. So what are the boundary conditions are there? So we have considered, we have solved this total thing in an ANSYS fluent. Okay, so in ANSYS fluent we have solved this total thing. First, this zone 1 actually solved. So in this zone 1, first this zone 1 is solved. So in this zone 1, MR fluid actually it is in Newtonian model. So here it is, it applies means we have considered this is a Newtonian fluid in zone 1. Okay, so fluid is actually entering into the polishing medium or entering into the finishing zone with a uniform velocity. This is the uniform inlet velocity. This velocity is actually considered with the assumption that this whatever piston velocity is there. So this piston velocity actually we are piston velocity in the medium cylinder. It is coming within certain velocity. Okay, so although this velocity is a sinusoidal, it will be a sinusoidal, it is not a constant, but we have considered as a average value of this piston velocity as the inlet velocity of the fluid into the zone 1. Okay, so this average velocity of this fluid at the inlet of this zone 1 is considered as the inlet velocity to this zone 1. So average velocity of this piston at this is considered as the inlet velocity of this fluid at in zone 1. So that is UB equal to constant here. So after it is entering into this zone, in zone 1, you can see this is the wall boundary here. So at this boundary, at the wall actually you have considered no slip boundary condition here. So here also you have considered no slip boundary condition, and at the along this axis, so this is the axis here. So along this axis we have considered axis symmetric boundary condition, and at the outlet actually we have considered this fully developed velocity profile, fully developed flow condition or fully developed velocity profile there at the outlet. We have means it is achieved, we have assumed there fully developed flow condition velocity profile is considered at the outlet of this zone 1. So, because of we are considering this fluid in the R and Z plane, so Vr, both Vr radial force and this axial force, both Vr and Vz perpendicular to this wall equal to 0, both Vr and Vz perpendicular to this wall is 0. Okay. So, and at the axis actually we have considered axisymmetric boundary condition. So, this axisymmetric boundary condition can be written as del Vz velocity of z direction velocity with respect to r equal to 0. So, gradient of velocity with respect to radial direction is 0. So, or del Vz by del r at r equal to 0 at the along the axis equal to 0. And Vr, there is no cross flow of this fluid along this axis. So, Vr also 0 along the axis of the zone 1. Okay. So, whatever this outlet velocity calculated from this zone 1, okay, so that is considered as the inlet to the zone 2. Okay. And also at this wall, along this wall, we have considered no slip boundary condition in zone 2. Okay. So, in zone 2, we have considered at this wall no slip boundary condition again. So, Vr and Vz, radial velocity and axial velocity both are 0 perpendicular to this wall. And again along this axis, we have considered del Vz by del r, axisymmetric boundary condition. And at this outlet actually, we have considered again fully developed flow condition or del Vz, del z equal to 0 along the outlet. And at the inlet actually, we have considered velocity which is coming from the outlet of this zone 1, which whatever velocity is there, it is considered as the inlet to the zone 2. Okay. So, for this computational domain, we have considered for zone 1, we have considered this, it is M1. So, different mesh we have considered for mesh independent test. So, this is M1, M2 and M3. With this 200 in this long distance, it is 200. In other cases, this is 13. Then this is 19. So, we have considered like this. So, in zone 1, we have considered like this. And for this zone 2, okay, so for this zone 2, this we have considered 200 elements along this x direction, means along this z direction, and along this radial direction, we have considered 40 elements. Okay. So, these are the elements here for mesh independent test for both zone 1 and zone 2, and we have found that in zone 1 actually there is no change in velocity profile for this 200 to 300. Okay. So, very small change in velocity profile is observed, and for this zone 2 also we have considered from 200 mesh size to 300 mesh size along this x direction. So, very few change in actually velocity profile is observed. So, from this discretization, this first mesh one M1 is considered for this zone 1 and M4 is considered for this zone 2 from grid independence test. So, after that we have to consider this viscosity model. As we have told that MR fluid actually it is a non-Newtonian fluid with the application of magnetic field. So, it can be considered as the Bingham plastic fluid with the application of magnetic field. So, this is the equation of a Bingham plastic fluid. When applied shear stress is greater than yield stress of this fluid, then shear stress equal to yield stress tau y plus mu p is the plastic viscosity into gamma dot is the shear rate. Okay. So, when applied shear stress is greater than yield stress of this fluid, so this is the equation for this shear stress. And when applied shear stress is less than yield stress of this fluid, then fluid does not flow. Okay. So, in that case shear rate equal to 0, fluid does not flow. So, shear rate equal to 0 in the second case when applied shear stress less than yield stress of this fluid. So, this Bingham plastic equation can be modeled here. So, this is the Bingham plastic equation for this case. This is the A, B, C, D. So, this is the line. So, this A B equal to tau y. When applied shear stress is greater than this tau y, then only this fluid will flow. Okay, so this is the after flowing. When the fluid flows, then it takes the path from takes the path B, C, D. Okay, so the slope of this line B, C, D will give the plastic viscosity mu p. Now this Bingham plastic model cannot be implied, cannot be we cannot use this one, because suddenly at this point at gamma dot equal to 0 here, suddenly at this point at the center actually it drops from a yield stress of tau y to suddenly it becomes to 0. Okay, so there is a discontinuity at this point B. So that's why people have actually considered modified biviscosity model. Biviscosity model, so where actually this flow path of this MR fluid, Bingham plastic fluid, is considered A, C, D. It is not A, B, C, D. So this is the A, C, D, this is the flow path for this modified biviscosity model. So in this case, initially there is a very high viscosity is there. So from A to C, there is a very high viscosity is there. So mu equal to mu 0, you can consider mu equal to 1000 into mu 0. So very high viscosity is considered at initially, very high viscosity mu 0 equal to 1000 of mu p. Mu p is the plastic viscosity. So you can consider this mu 0 initial viscosity, very high viscosity equal to 1000 equal to mu p, you can consider. Okay. So after that, when it crosses the C point, then it takes the viscosity as mu ps, or plastic viscosity is considered. So this is the biviscosity model. In this biviscosity model, when gamma dot is less than equal to gamma dot C, critical shear rate, so in when shear rate is less than the critical shear rate, so in that case viscosity is very high, mu 0, mu equal to mu 0, and when shear rate is greater than critical shear rate, so in that case you can consider this viscosity as mu equal to mu p, plastic viscosity plus tau y by gamma dot. So this is the viscosity when applied shear rate is greater than critical shear rate. Okay, so after it gets achieves that critical shear rate, then it takes the path of CD. Okay, so this is the biviscosity model. So here also there is a discontinuity at this point C, because beyond this value, this takes the viscosity as mu p, plastic viscosity, but before that means when it passes the point C, then in that case viscosity is equal to mu p plus tau y by gamma dot. It is a function of shear rate. But when it at the left hand side, when it does not reach up to this C point, in that case high viscosity of this fluid is considered. So at this C point, actually it is a point of discontinuity in case of modified biviscosity model. So that's why people have actually developed so many models. Among them, so this is the Papathanasu. He developed this model tau equal to tau y 1 minus e to the power m into gamma dot plus mu p into gamma dot. So this is the equation he developed in 1987. So this same equation, one equation can be used as actually two, can be represented as the two equations in case of modified biviscosity model. So this one equation can be considered as the two equation. It can take care of the two equations for modified biviscosity model. So one equation tau equal to tau y 1 minus e to the power minus m into gamma dot plus mu p into gamma dot. So this is the equation for Papanasu model, which means it can be considered as the, it considers both the cases of modified biviscosity model. Okay. So in this case, this viscosity is a function of shear rate and equal to mu p plus tau y by gamma dot 1 minus e to the power m into gamma dot. Okay. So if we consider very high value of m, so in that case this Papathanasu model, it actually takes the shape of the Bingham plastic model. Okay, so if we consider very high value of this m, for a high value of m, this Papadanso model actually it takes the shape of the Bingham plastic model. Okay, viscosity in that case Papadanso model equal to mu p plus tau y by gamma dot 1 minus e to the power m into gamma dot. Okay, so that this value of ua, this axial velocity should be like that m ua by d should be greater than 500. So this is the model, Papadanso model. So this model actually it is utilized in Fluent. So we have written a user defined function for this Papadanso model for viscosity, or for viscosity model we have developed the, we have used this Papadanso model. Okay, for calculating the viscosity. Okay, so now we need to do the grid independent test. So you can see this zone 1 and this is the zone 2, this velocity profile at for a different three different grids. Okay, so these grids for zone 1 you can see here. So you can see that this velocity, there is no change in the velocity profile for this zone 1. So this maximum velocity at this point for this zone 1, you can see from m equal to 200, m1 equal to 200 along this length direction, then second one is the m1 equal to 300, and third direction m1 equal to 400. So in between this 200 and 300 mesh along this x direction, you can see there is only 0.04% change in velocity profile. And in zone 2 also we can see, if we plot for 200, for 300 and for 400, you can see, so from this 200 to 300 there is very fine change in velocity profile can be observed. Okay, so we can consider this 200 by 40, this 200 by 40, this one as the, we can consider this 200 by 40, this mesh actually it is considered for this optimized mesh for zone 2, and for zone 1 this 200, 13, 91, 36, 89, and along this z direction it is 41, is considered as the optimum mesh size for zone 1. So for grid independent test we have considered 30% by volume CL grade abrasive CIP particles, carbon iron particles, and then 10% by volume silicon carbide abrasive particles with 600 mesh size as the polishing media, and grease we have considered this 12% grease and paraffin oil has 48%. All these values are actually considered from the optimum polishing fluid selection, which is discussed earlier, where we have studied the rheological property of this polishing media. So this inlet velocity to this media, average inlet velocity of this polishing media is considered 13.60 millimeter per second. So it depends on the pressure. So at 37.5 bar pressure, this inlet velocity is 13.60 millimeter per second at 0.29 Tesla magnetic field, because in that case we have considered N17 grade of, iron particles. So in zone 1, this viscosity of this polishing media is considered 4.5 Pascal second, and yield stress of this fluid is considered as 104.7 Pascal. Okay, so this in zone 1, although we are not applying any magnetic field, but while doing this rheological characterization, we have seen that at a very less amount of viscosity and yield stress is actually observed. So you can see here this viscosity is 4.5 Pascal second, although in zone 2 at 0.29 Tesla magnetic field, this viscosity is 18.41 Pascal second. Okay, so now yield stress also you can see here, in case of zone 1 this yield stress is 104.7 Pascal, but in the polishing zone where we have applied magnetic field, there it is 18.32 kilo Pascal. So it is very high. So in zone 1 it is very less, in zone 2 it is very high. So that's why a little bit of this viscosity and yield stress is observed, although its value is less, but for getting accurate results, we have considered this one into our simulation. Okay. Now we have to do the validation of our model. Okay, validation of our model, fluent model. Okay, fluent results with some analytical results. So there are some analytical solution available for fully developed Bingham plastic pipe flow. So this one is taken from Chhabra and Richardson in 2008. Their published book, from their published book. So here this velocity along this z direction can be calculated as minus del p by l. Del p is the pressure gradient, l is the length of this pipe where you are applying magnetic field, and r is the capital R is the radius of this cylinder. Okay, small r is the radius at any point. Okay, tau y is the yield stress, mu p is the plastic viscosity. Okay, so this equation will give the velocity analytical velocity profile at any cross section, at any radius, or at any length, along any length of this workpiece, or at any length of this computational domain. Okay, and then so this r, actually this r greater than rc, critical radius, r greater than equal to critical radius means this one first one is the in the shear zone, and r greater than 0 less than equal to rc. So when r is less than critical radius of this cylindrical fixture, okay, so in that case this velocity profile is like this, minus del p by l capital R square by 4 mu p, 1 minus rc is the critical radius, rc by r, r is the total radius of this fixture. So this one more item is there, number is there, that is called Bingham number. So Bingham number, it is defined as tau y by tau y into d into by divided by mu p into mu a. So here this Reynolds number can be written as rho u b, u is the inlet velocity, uniform velocity, d is the diameter, and mu a divided by mu a into zeta. Zeta can be calculated from this equation, and mu also can be calculated from this equation. So by plotting all these things at different Bingham number, and in every case actually we have done this analytical solution, we have calculated analytical solution from Bingham number 0 to here, at the top Bingham number 0 to Bingham number 10 we have plotted here. Okay, so at Bingham number 0 means it is like a Newtonian fluid, and when you are increasing this Bingham number from 0 to 10, so it becomes as a non-Newtonian fluid, okay, with higher viscosity and yield stress. So our model actually matches with the analytical solution. Okay, so we can tell that our model is validated now. Now we have to do the velocity distribution of the polishing media in zone 1. In zone 1, after doing this fluent simulation, okay, before that actually we want to tell something, what is the numerical method we have used. So we have used actually semi-implicit method for a pressure link equation proposed by Patankar. So that method actually is used for discretization, okay, for discretization of continuity equation and momentum equation. This Patankar's semi-implicit method for pressure link equation, simple method is used, okay. And now for this viscous term actually we have used central difference method, and for this convective term we have used second order Apoin method for this convective term. So these total things actually, using ANSYS fluent, okay. So it is run using ANSYS fluent. Now you can see from this contour plot, in the unfinished zone or shear zone, you can see without application of magnetic field, okay, so velocity distribution without application of the magnetic field you can see here, okay. So at the inlet actually we have considered the uniform velocity profile. So after so that's why here in this zone almost similar velocity is observed. Okay, so now you can see after extrusion after extrusion you can see here. Okay, so this velocity gradient changes. So velocity at the center is actually minimum, and velocity at the wall workpiece fixture wall, at this fixture wall actually is velocity is gradient actually very high, and at the wall actually velocity again it is zero. So at the wall velocity velocity gradient is very high, and at the center you can see here this velocity almost same. So this means that this velocity means this MR fluid actually after extrusion actually it comes to a fully developed flow condition is achieved after crossing this fluid from this extrusion zone. Okay, so here you can see here in this zone itself your this MR fluid actually it develops fully developed flow condition. Here this is the vector plot you can see here. At this vector plot you can see this, at this zone you can see this is the fully developed flow condition is achieved. So here this velocity is very less here, and here velocity profile actually changes here, and we can see higher velocity at the wall and lesser velocity at the along the cylinder center. So this is the viscosity model we have considered. So tau y yield stress of this fluid in zone 1 is 85.33 Pascal second, and plastic viscosity is 3.4 Pascal second. Okay, so in zone 2 this it will be Pascal. So in zone 2 this tau y is 37 kilo Pascal kPa, and plastic viscosity is 40.77 Pascal second. So after doing the velocity profile at the finish means at this without in the zone where we are not applying magnetic field, we have to go for velocity profile. We have to go for velocity profile for the finishing zone. So in this finishing zone there is no extrusion. So here we have applied this magnet. So these magnets is applied in this zone in the finishing zone. So you can see here that. So here in the finishing zone. So after entering the fluid in the finishing zone, in between 0 to 0.01, so near to 0.01 meter, you can see this fluid is actually fully developed flow condition is achieved. So full fluid becomes fully developed when it reaches up to 0.01 meter along the length of the workpiece fixture, where we have applied this magnetic field. Okay, so this is the vector plot of this fluid which is obtained from ANSYS. Okay, so in this vector plot you can see here this is the inlet velocity we have given. So this inlet velocity is taken from the outlet of the velocity of the zone 1. So that outlet velocity is taken as the input in zone 2. Here we can see that this velocity gradient actually it is constant up to this point. After that this velocity gradient actually changes. Okay, so fully developed flow condition you can see here. So here itself this fully developed flow condition can be achieved. So without any magnetic field, so this is with the application of magnetic field at 0.5 tesla magnetic field. So without application of magnetic field, here you can see these velocity profiles are parabolic in nature. Okay, but with the application of magnetic field, these velocity profiles actually uniform at the center, where this core uniform at the center. So where core material is there and solid core region is there, and at the wall actually this MR fluid actually it is shear. So without application of magnetic field there is no solid core region in case of MR fluid. Okay, so without application on magnetic field. So as the fluids are not magnetized, so we will not get sufficient forces to control the abrasive particles onto the particle surface. So after doing this one, this computational fluid dynamic simulation of MR polishing fluid both in zone 1 and zone 2, we can calculate what are the axial force and what is the radial force. So obviously we can get this shear stress and radial stress from this simulation. If we know the shear stress and radial stress, so we can calculate how much force is coming to a individual abrasive particles. If we have a abrasive particles, they are having a certain structure. If the abrasive particles are considered under a certain structure, then only we can calculate how much force is coming on individual abrasive particles. Okay, so force on a small ferromagnetic particle of mass m can be calculated. Force on a small ferromagnetic particle of mass m can be calculated as Fm equal to m into chi m b del b divided by mu 0. So m is the mass of these abrasive particles, chi m is the susceptibility of this m is the mass of this CIP particles, carbon and iron particles. So after calculating the forces, axial and radial forces from computational fluid dynamics simulation, we are going to calculate the magnetic forces on the abrasive particles through surrounding CIP particles, okay, so using magnetic field analysis. So what are the force acting on a carbon iron particles or ferromagnetic particle in a magnetic field? So this is the equation, Fm equal to m chi b into gradient b divided by mu 0 will give the force acting on a single ferromagnetic particle under magnetic field. So m is the mass of the ferromagnetic particle, chi m is the susceptibility of this ferromagnetic particle, and then b is the magnetic field intensity, and grad b is the gradient of the magnetic field intensity divided by mu 0. Mu 0 here actually permeability in free space. Okay, so this equation can be written in terms of function x at a distance x from the from the magnet. So we have considered the distance from the magnet. Okay, so this is Fm x equal to m into chi m divided by mu 0 b into x, magnetic field intensity with as a function of x, and dB dx as a function of x. Okay, so for here mass of individual abrasive particles is known, susceptibility of the magnetic particle can be calculated from the parallel field vibrating sample magnetometer BSM model 5 AD magnetics, okay, USA. So it is used for to find out the MH curve. Okay, so it is used to find out the MH curve for MR magnetorological polishing fluid. A cylindrical container of 3 millimeter diameter and 2 millimeter thickness was filled with the medium and placed in between the magnets of magnetometer. Okay, so from there, so if it escaped inside a magnetic field, okay, so we can calculate this magnetic susceptibility from there itself. Okay, so this is the MH curve here. So from this MH curve, we can calculate the magnetic susceptibility at any distance, okay, as a function of x, you can calculate. And also from this curve, you can calculate what is the B, magnetic field intensity as a function of x, we can calculate. And if we know this dB, B, so we can calculate its gradient dB dx with, as a function of x. Okay, so chi m can be calculated as m by h, m is the magnetization, h is the applied magnetic field, equal to mu 0 and into m by b. Okay, so b equal to mu 0 into h, so h can be replaced by mu 0 by b, b by mu 0. Okay, h can be replaced as b by mu 0 here. Okay, so from this equation, from here, from this MH curve, which is obtained from this vibration sample magnetometer BSM, we can calculate BX, dB dx and susceptibility, and M is already known, and mu 0 is a constant permeability in free space. So now we have to calculate the BX. What is the value of B? What is the value of B? As a function of X. So we have applied these two magnets, two permanent magnets here. North pole and south pole of these magnets are there. Here this is the workpiece fixture. Two flat workpieces just here and here. Two flat workpieces are used. Stainless steel workpieces are kept, and this fixture actually it is filled up with magnetorheological polishing fluid. And for calculating this simulation, we have considered this MR fluid is in the static case. Okay, so for we have considered the MR fluid in the static case, and in the same similar case, actually we have done the simulation using Maxwell, we did this simulation. Okay, so here this is the fixture here, and two poles of the magnets are there, and you can see magnetic license force from south pole to north pole, it is moving from south pole to the north pole. Okay, so it is passing through this MR fluid here. So along this line, so if we draw a line there along this line, we can calculate what is the magnetic field. Okay, along this line, so it is at a distance of x, we can calculate here. So distance from x equal to 0 to 27, so this is the diameter of the cylinder, diameter of the workpiece cylinder here. So in between, so distance between two workpieces there, so this is 27 millimeter. So in between these two workpieces, actually we can calculate this magnetic force. Also at the same time, we have calculated the magnetic force, magnetic field, and at the same time we have calculated the magnetic field using Gauss meter also. So this dotted one you can see here, so this one is for N48 magnet and this one is for N17 permanent magnet. Okay, so this dotted one here, this is the simulation reals and experiment reals at the bottom, here also experiment reals at the bottom, and top one is the simulation reals. So we can see, although this simulation reals, maximal simulation reals is means higher than the normal case. Okay, so in normal case you can see these abrasive particles are also there, but in our case actually we are not consider these abrasive particles. Okay, so that's why this in normal case, that's all these CIP particles are CIP chains are not constant chains, longer as a continuous chains, there is a breakage is there, but in during simulation it is not considered. Okay, so it is considered as a homogeneous fluid. Okay, so that's why simulation reals we got the higher value. So but there is a very less difference in between the simulation and experimental reals, so we can say that they are reals almost matching. Okay, so these are the two magnets, N17 and N48, two magnets are there. So cross section of these magnets, dimensions of the magnets are written here. And magnet property, this remnant magnetization, corrosive force, and BH max, area of this BH curve. Okay, so this is also given. So these values are actually given as input to the permanent magnet for during this simulation, Maxwell simulation. So from this Maxwell simulation, we got this B value, magnetic field value, as a function of X. So this B actually is required. Here we can put this value B here, and if we get this B as a function of X, we can get this dB dx. Okay, so modeling of chain structure, now we have to model the chain structure. Okay, so study of chain structure helps in understanding the role of particle size on surface finish improvement. CIPs, covalent particles acquire magnetic dipole moment in the presence of external magnetic field and aggregate into the chains of dipoles aligned along the magnetic field direction. These chains form the columnar structure along the magnetic field directions, magnetic lines of force at higher concentration of carbon and iron particles. Due to the presence of non-magnetic abrasive particles, these chains are not continuous chain. So these chains, CIP particle chains are discontinuous chain, because when abrasive particles are there, it coming in front of the chain, path. So these chains actually breaks. Okay, so these chains are not continuous chain. So iron particles, the assumptions are that iron particles rearrange around silicon carbon particles in the direction of the magnetic field and repeat itself in the complete volume spanning from one end to the other end of the magnet. So in between two poles of the magnet, the abrasive particle taking part in the metal removal are forming a half BCC structure, that we shall discuss here. So here you can see this is the north pole here. So here we have considered only one half of the fixture. So this is the center line of this fixture. Here the south pole will be there. So from north means from center to this point up to this workpiece fixture, you can see these CIP particles are forming half BCC structure and abrasive particles are kept in between this CIP structure. In between this carbon nanoparticle structure, we have considered these abrasive particles. Okay, so these abrasive particles are actually indented into the workpiece surface. So it will give the indentation into the workpiece surface, these abrasive particles, it will give the indentation into the workpiece surface. Okay, and when it is indented, we are giving this kind of axial force. Because of this axial force, this indented material will be removed. So now we have to calculate how much force is coming on these abrasive particles, because these CIP chains are forming this layer from layer X1 to up to this layer, up to this final layer. So how many layers are there, we have to consider. Okay, so from each layer actually this abrasive these CIP chains are contributing this force, magnetic force, into these abrasive particles. So this total magnetic force can be calculated from layer 1, I1, 2 up to this final layer n. Okay. So this if we know this distance x1, x2 up to this xn, so now we can calculate what should be the force. Okay. So this number of layers can be calculated as radius of the fixture minus x1 plus this L, this is the length, half length of this BC structure. Okay. So if we divided by this L, we will give the total number of layer, and individual layer x1 can be calculated as this, the r2 is the radius of this abrasive particle, plus r1 plus r2 by root 3, this is the half this portion from here to center to this center, this is actually x means this r2 plus r1 plus r2 by root 3, this half of the distance of this this half BC structure. So from here x1 can be calculated, and then x2, x3 can be similarly can be calculated. X1, x2 equal to x1 plus length of this BC structure. So like that up to xn can be calculated. So now, there are two zones. One is the media cylinder zone and another workpiece fixture zone. So volumetric flow rate should be constant along this media fixture, media along this media cylinder zone and the workpiece fixture zone. Okay, so pi rp square total cross sectional area multiplied by the stroke length of this piston equal to pi rf square, rf is the radius of this fixture, multiplied by this extrusion length. Okay, so now we can equate these two things. Now from there you can calculate what is the value of this extrusion length. Now how many abrasive particles are there, we can calculate this extrusion length divided by this total means length of individual half BC structure. It will give the LE by L, will give the how many abrasive particles are there. So how many active abrasive particles? So here one abrasive, another active abrasive, how many active abrasive? So total length of this extrusion length divided by this length of individual abrasive means individual half BC structure. Length of this structure, if we divide, then we can calculate what should be the layers, how many active abrasive particles are taking part into the material removal. So this is the length of this BCC structure. Okay, so this is 2R1 plus R2 by root 3. So from here we can calculate this total force acting on these abrasive particles through CIP carbon iron particles chains. Okay. Now we have to calculate what is the depth of indentation. For calculating this depth of indentation, we are considering the magnetic force plus radial force. So because of this magnetic force and radial force, these abrasive particles are indented into the workpiece surface. Now you can see this half of this spherical sphere. sphere. We have considered this average particle size sphere here, and model works directly on the initial surface roughness data, whatever from SURF analyzer, whatever data we got. So it works on the exactly same data, on the same data of surface roughness data, for making the simultaneous simulations more realistic. Okay. So to update the surface profiler after this stroke, depth of indentation by a spherical average particle on its peak is calculated. So depth of indentation, we have to calculate how much depth it is indented, this average particle is indented into the workpiece surface. So it can be calculated from this equation, from the geometry of this figure. So this is the average particle is here. So this is the cross section of the average particle which is indented into the workpiece surface. So this is the depth of indentation. Now this average particle is actually, it is sheared into the workpiece surface, and this much material will be removed from this workpiece surface. So this diameter of this average particle is the dg, and in depth of indentation is t here, you can see this is the depth of indentation, and the diameter of this indentation is di here. Okay. So now depth of indentation, from the geometry of this figure you can calculate the depth of indentation. Okay. So now we know this for being Brinell hardness number. Okay. So if the some on a steel ball, if you put pressure on a steel ball, so this much will be the Brinell hardness number. So F is the normal indentation force on the on the steel ball. Okay. So the dg is the diameter of this ball, and di is the indentation diameter of this ball. So indentation diameter you can calculate from here. Okay. So if we put all these values, and we know this Brinell hardness number of this workpiece material. Okay. From there you can calculate the diameter of indentation. So depth of indentation and diameter of indentation we know, and if we put these values of this depth of indentation and diameter of indentation into this equation, you can calculate this, how much material is removed by each abrasive particle. So this much material, cross section of this material is removed, which is given by a dash by each abrasive particles. Now it is, when it is translated horizontally, this much length multiplied by length will be, this much material will be removed from the workpiece surface. So here one more thing is that the shear force on this abrasive particle should be greater than strength of this workpiece material. So this shear force acting on this abrasive particle should be greater than the strength of this workpiece material. This shear force can be calculated. A is the total cross sectional area minus this A dashed is the cross, means A dashed is the cross sectional area which is indented into the workpiece surface. So this, on this area actually this shear force acting, this shear force should be greater than this indentation, should be greater than this strength of this workpiece material. Okay, so this shear force can be calculated here, A minus A dashed into shear stress of this fluid, and Fr can be calculated. This is the A dashed here, indented at cross section area multiplied by yield point stress of this workpiece material. So F shear should be greater than Fr. So we have calculated this force, this F shear, from our simulation, magnetic field simulation. We can see that here it is 10 to the minus 5 range, and this resistance offered by this workpiece material, it is into the 10 to the minus 3 range. It is very small. So this workpiece, these abrasive particles are shearing to the from the workpiece material. Okay, so it is very very higher than the shear force is very very high than the strength of this workpiece material or resistance offered by the workpiece material. Okay, so now surface roughness, we have to do the surface roughness simulation. So this surface roughness profiles, it is taken from the instrument itself. So these instruments will give the peaks and valleys, all this information will give. So these the peaks are there, so these different peaks are available here, and these are the different valleys are available, and this is the mean line here. So mean line is calculated, it is the average between the peaks and valleys. Okay. So now this is the abrasive particle which is moving from left to right. So it will remove the surface undulations from the peaks here. Okay. So from each and every peak it will remove the depth of indentation. Okay. So it will not remove material from each and every peak. So suppose if this the peak height is PA minus T. Okay. So this much will be removed from here, this much will be removed from here, this much will be removed, but from this PB it will not remove. because we have considered this, assume that these abrasive particles will move in a straight line path. Because your shear stress is very high, okay, shear stress is very high in our case, so these abrasive particles will move in a straight line path. So after this cutting the peaks, you can see PA, this peak will become PA dashed, PC will become this PC dashed, and PD will become PD dashed. And then after some time, when this abrasive particle will come here, then only it will remove the peaks from PB also. So after that, so after each and every iteration, this del y, there is a mean shift of del y. So mean, this old mean line is top in that at the top. After that, it will be shifted at the bottom direction. So this is the new mean line. So this del y amount, it will be shifted at every point. So cutting occurs at every peak is pi greater than pi max minus t, then only this cutting occurs, otherwise there is no cutting. So after cutting, we will see that these peaks values, okay, so array can be calculated from this yi values, all these new yi values divided by number of peaks, okay, number of peaks and valleys, this average value will give the surface roughness after each iteration. Now we have to do the parametric study at different CIP concentration. We have done parametric study from 10.15 CIP concentration up to 32.0 CIP concentration. At every concentration, we have measured the piston velocity. Okay, so these are the piston velocity with this uniform piston velocity at the zone 1. Okay, so yield stress of this fluid and viscosity of this fluid in zone 1 and 1, zone 2 are actually, it is calculated from the rheological study. Okay, so from rheological study, we have calculated this yield stress and viscosity in zone 1 and zone 2, and this inlet velocity, it is calculated at different CIP concentration from the piston velocity. So this is the inlet velocity at zone 1 and radial velocity in zone 1. Okay, and this is the inlet velocity, this is the velocity profile at the outlet, at the outlet of this zone 2. So at this zone 2, you can see this kind of flat. So this is one half of the fixture, because we have considered the axisymmetric case. So this is the one half of the fixture. So here up to this point, you can see there is no change in the velocity gradient. So velocity is constant. Okay, so this portion is the solid core region. And here this portion actually yielded, shear zone. Okay, so now we can see here, velocity at higher at less CIP concentration is more at higher CIP concentration, because when you are increasing the CIP concentration, this CIP chain structure will become columnar structure and more strong chains will be formed. So with the same pressure, if you are flowing this fluid, this velocity will reduce with higher CIP concentration. Same case for this here also in the zone 2 also. So velocity will be higher for less CIP concentration than higher CIP concentration. Okay, so here we can see this axial shear stress also is higher, shear stress is higher for higher CIP concentration, and also radial stress is higher for higher CIP concentration. So with this information, so now this MH curve also is drawn from VSM, vibrating sample magnetometer. And also this magnetic field analysis is also done at different CIP concentration. Okay. So at different CIP, it is higher concentration, it is lesser concentration. So magnetic force also increases. And you can, from this information, actually, we can calculate the, what is the average radial stress, radial force, magnetic force, and indentation into the workplace surface. So you can see this indentation. At higher CIP concentration, this indentation in the 10 to the minus 13 range on individual abrasive particles, and at lower CIP concentration, it is 10 to the minus 14 range. Okay. So now this is the initial workpiece surface roughness profile, this is the final surface roughness profile, and this one is the experimental surface roughness profile. So now we can see this simulated surface roughness and experimental surface roughness profile almost matching here. So this is the initial surface at 10.15% CIP concentration. This surface roughness profile, it is achieved, it is obtained from the surface roughness measuring machine. On that profile, actually, we have done the simulation. So we can see this is the cut. Okay. So you can see this is the cut. So this is the simulated surface roughness profile. So this is the experimental surface roughness profile after polishing. So here you can see this top portion is cut, peaks values are cut. Here also you can see this peak portions are somewhere it is cut here. So this is the 32 CIP concentration. You can see the initial surface roughness profile of 0.21 micron. This is the simulated surface roughness profile on this initial surface roughness. After simulation, we got this 0.07 micron, and after this is the experimental surface roughness profile, we got 0.09 micron. So experimental we got higher. We got this higher surface roughness values. So after that, we have done the parametric study for extrusion pressure also. At different extrusion pressure, we have plotted the piston velocity. Using this piston velocity, we have plotted the inlet velocity, outlet velocity from zone 1, radial velocity, axial. This is the axial velocity in at the outlet of this zone 1, radial velocity at this outlet of this zone 1, and this is the axial velocity at the outlet of zone 2. Okay, so you can see here with, so this is the less pressure and this is the high pressure. With high pressure, you can see this solid core region actually reduces using the high pressure. Okay, so because it is shear, so if you increase the shear, most of the fluid at certain magnetic field, at a constant magnetic field, most of the fluid will be shear. And you can see there with the increasing in the pressure, so you can see, so with the increasing pressure, your axial and radial stress also changes or increases here. Okay, so because we are using in this case only single fluid, so at different pressure we are doing the experiments. So this is the MH curve and this is the this magnetic field in between these two pole, magnetic field plot in between two workpieces or in between the two poles of the electromagnet. So at different pressures, 32.5 bar to 42.5 bar pressure, this indentation diameter, you can see it is little bit increasing. So there is not that much changes are there. From 2.402, we got this 2.61 into 10 to the minus 3 range. Okay. So with the increasing pressure, we can see surface finish also improves. This is the initial surface roughness profile, this is the final surface roughness profile, and after that, this is the experimental surface roughness profile. After that, we have done the experiments on finishing cycles also, 400 finishing cycles to 800 finishing cycles. So we can see almost similar final surface roughness profile, simulated final surface roughness, and this is the experimental final surface roughness profile, almost they are matching. Okay. So these are the conclusions from our experimental study. Rheological characterization, from rheological characterization we have seen that Herschel-Walkley model actually better represents the experimental data obtained from the rheometer and Bingham plastic than Bingham plastic and Casson fluid models. And from ANOVAS and analysis, we have seen that magnetic field has the highest contribution on yield stress and viscosity of MR fluid, and from all the main factors and interactions. So we have considered this 10.71 at 17.68. So these are the, after that, CIP concentration, okay, contribution of this CIP concentration. And highest yield stress is obtained for 30% CIP, 10% abrasive, 12% grease, and 48% paraffin oil at 0.5 Tesla magnetic field. So it is also observed that when the total solid content CIP plus abrasive of the MRP fluid reaches more than 35%, there is a decrease in yield stress. So rate of decrease in yield stress depends on the total solid particles concentration in MRP fluid beyond this 35%. So from rotational MRP process of flat workpieces, so RMRP process is more effectively reducing the surface roughness than MRFA process. RMP process is less efficient for finishing magnetic workpiece, ANET workpiece, okay. And the combination of S and rotational speed of the magnet and square of the rotational speed of the magnet, highest contribution has the highest contribution. Okay, so percent change in RA increases with the rotational speed of the magnet. After that, it reaches to an optimum value and then it reduces because of the shear thinning fluid of shear thinning nature of the fluid. And also average particles cut marks generates cross hatch pattern on the workpiece surface. Okay, it generates cross hatch pattern. And then from cylindrical workpiece also we got that it is capable of polishing cylindrical workpiece, cylindrical stainless steel workpiece. Also it can reduce the outer roughness of this workpiece, cylindrical workpieces. Okay, so from abrasive flow machine, atomic force microscope and scanning electron images, we have seen that abrasive particles give the generous cross pattern on the workpiece surface, which helps in oil retention. Okay, so simulation from MRFA process, MRFA is compression or fluid dynamic simulation of MRFA process. So this axial velocity profile of the simulation reals matches well with the analytical solution of Bingham plastic pipe flow equation. It is also observed that numerical simulation higher extrusion pressure, that higher extrusion pressure give rise to a smaller flux flow region at a given magnetic field. From the comparison of magnetic field between Maxwell simulation reals with the experimental measured magnetic field without polishing medium, it is found that they are in good agreement. From the magnetic field simulation, it has been found that this axial force on an active abrasive plane is greater than the reaction force due to the strength of this material. Hence, it is concluded that shearing action of the abrasive particle on the workpiece surface takes place during finishing. And also these final surface roughness values predicted from the simulation reals are very close to the experimental reals of the finished surface for experiments at different CIP concentration, at different workpiece extrusion, at different extrusion pressure. Okay. So these are the references are there, and thank you.